All right. Well, welcome, everybody. Thank you for being here. And let's get going with our second panel. I'm Dante Oshini. I'm a professor at the Harvard Business School. And I'm the co-chair with Hans-Helmut here of the European Economic Policy Forum. Wolfgang said earlier that it's difficult to define exactly what a crisis is. Certainly in the Eurozone, I guess we know a crisis when we have one on our hands, and we definitely do. We've had one for some time, and in fact, it's an existential crisis. So over the next 90 minutes, that's what we're going to try and discuss. The Eurozone, of course, has been shaken since the global financial crisis came to our shores back in 2010, really. It became the sovereign debt crisis, which flared up in Greece, and then propagated over various countries, reached a critical point in 2012. And as the Eurozone leaders tried to battle the crisis, many of them were swept away, of course. They took a number of unprecedented institutional measures to try to reinforce the union's foundations, in particular by creating resolution tools, moving towards a banking union, and implementing some competitiveness and economic adjustments. Unfortunately, little was done in the way of any creating any common fiscal capacity, and of course, in creating any element of a political union. The ECB played a key role in trying to stem the crisis by adopting gradually more aggressive and unorthodox policies at market speed. So initially, that stemmed the systemic meltdown, but frankly, it's appearing to lose a little bit of potency as time goes by, and is now openly, in fact, under attack by several politicians. So we're not out of the woods. Challenges remain. The banks are a big worry, of course. Inflation is not picking up. Budget deficit discussions are creating a lot of tensions, as is the inability to create a common response to the migrant crisis, the inability to have a common defense policy. Especially at a time where it is likely to see a potential U.S. disengagement from that standpoint. Anyway, we are fortunate to have a wonderful panel with us today. So let me briefly introduce my colleagues, who you probably all know. But Jeffry Frieden is a professor of government at Harvard University. He specializes in the politics of international monetary and financial relations. His latest book last year was Currency Politics, the Political Economy of Exchange Rate Policy. So spot on for our discussion. I'm particularly grateful to Jeff for being here, actually, because he's teaching this morning, so he will be leaving us at 12 o'clock, so thank you for being here. Hans-Helmut Kotz, he's my co-chair, and he's a visiting professor of economics here at Harvard every year, and he's on the economics faculty at Freiburg University. He's been on the board of the Deutsche Bundesbank, and has been a member of many committees at the ECB, at the Bank for International Settlements, at the Financial Stability Board, at the OECD, and he specializes on the EMU and financial stability, so it's great to have you. Peter Hall is known to you all, is the Krupp Foundation Professor of European Studies in the Department of Government at Harvard, and is a resident faculty of CES, of course. He has written many books. Yes, can you hear me?
We couldn't hear you yet.
Oh, okay, can you hear me now? I don't know. The volume is okay. Thank you. So anyway, he has written many books and hundreds of articles on European policymaking. So he's a fine connoisseur of that. And Christopher Smart, he is a senior fellow of the Mossavar Rahmani Center at the Harvard Kennedy School, and he spent the last 6 years in the Obama administration, and he's a senior policymaker for international economic affairs. And he was special assistant to the president of the National Economic Council. He was also deputy assistant secretary of the Treasury from 2009 to 2013, so the height of the crisis in some ways, where he led the response to the European financial crisis and designed U.S. engagement on financial policy across Europe. So it will be very interesting to have your views. So as we did before, each panelist 10 to 12 minutes, and then that should leave us half an hour for questions with that.
Thank you very much, Dante. It's a pleasure to be here again. I wish, actually, it's not that great a pleasure, because I keep coming back, or we keep coming back, talking about the crisis. And the sad reality is that much of what we said 3, 4, even 5 years ago about the crisis could be simply repeated today. So I apologize in advance to those who have heard me rant and rave about what's been missing in the response to the crisis. But unfortunately, we are still in the midst of the most serious crisis in the history of European integration. It does remind me, there's a famous Faulkner quote where he says, the past isn't dead, it isn't even past. And that's the other quote that it reminds me of, Tom Lear, the American song satirist, who said that, speaking about a similar kind of crisis, which was US and Vietnam, is that the country felt a bit like a Christian Scientist with appendicitis. And so I think that's what a lot of us feel like thinking about the Eurozone crisis, because the European Union and the Eurozone in particular is still in the grips of a devastating debt crisis with extraordinarily sweeping economic and political implications. Now, it's, at one level, it's not surprising that the crisis has lasted as long as it has. If you've read or even skimmed the well-known book by Carmen Reinhart and Ken Rogoff, This Time is Different, you'll know that looking at 180 or 200 debt crises over the last couple of hundred years, on average, they take 5 to 7 years to be resolved. So in some sense, the Eurozone is on track, although it seems to be on the far side of the 5 to 7 years. But nonetheless, one would have hoped that an organization, an international organization like the European Union, would find much better ways of resolving and much quicker ways of resolving what is, in fact, a devastating economic and political crisis. Why is the crisis taking so long to even come close to approaching a resolution? There are both economic and political reasons. The others on this panel, I think, will focus, because I would learn something from it, about some of the longer-term institutional causes and effects of the crisis and what some of the forces might be coming out of the crisis that might affect the longer-term future of the European Union and its institutions. But I want to focus more directly on the core of the economic crisis that the Eurozone has been facing, which is a debt crisis, a classic debt crisis, a crisis in which countries borrowed heavily. The heavy borrowing led to an economic expansion. The economic expansion led to a boom. The boom led to a bubble. Eventually, the bubble burst, and the societies in question, both creditor and debtor, are left with a debt overhang, that is, a burden of accumulated debt, bad debts in many instances, that have to be dealt with. And there are both economic and political implications of this. The first set of economic implications of this debt overhang is on both the creditor and the debtor side. From the standpoint of creditors, the debt overhang means, in the case of Europe, that there are trillions of dollars or trillions of euros worth of debts, many of which the financial institutions know are bad, and many more of which they fear may be bad. And in a circumstance like that, financial institutions have no incentive to take on new, potentially risky loans. Right? So financial institutions faced with and burdened with a debt overhang stop lending. And in particular, stop lending to enterprises that are anything below blue chip, the most reliable in the environment. So banks have stopped lending, or at least the level of credit creation in the Eurozone reflects tremendous pressure on banks to do everything possible to restore the quality of their balance sheets and not take on new loans. On the debtor side, you have debtors, whether those debtors are governments or households or banks or non-financial corporations, that have major burdens of debts that they are having great difficulties in servicing. In order to continue to service those debts, they have to cut back on their consumption or on their spending more generally. So if you're thinking about households, and much of the debt in the European Union, especially in the peripheral countries, is household debt, mortgage debt, as it is in the US, households have to cut back on their consumption in order to service their outstanding debts. So on the one hand, we have banks not lending. On the other hand, we have consumers not spending. And all of that exercises a real drag on economic recovery. So there's the purely economic consequences of a debt overhang, which we see in all debt crises, and we are seeing in spades in the current Eurozone crisis. But for me, the most serious effects are political. Every debt crisis that I know of, and every debt crisis that Reinhart and Rogoff write about, ends up almost immediately as a political conflict. And the conflict is over how the burden of adjustment to the debt will be distributed. Who will bear the costs for dealing with the accumulated debt? There are clear, certainly going to be winners and losers. There are going to be some who are going to be asked to make sacrifices and others who are going to be beneficiaries of the sacrifices made. And the politics of the Eurozone debt crisis, like the politics of every debt crisis, are about who is going to make those sacrifices and who are going to be the beneficiaries. Because this is an international debt crisis, one dimension of this conflict is international, between creditor countries on the one hand and debtor countries on the other hand. You have creditor countries that want to get paid back and debtor countries that want their debts to be restructured. At this point in the Eurozone, what has happened is that, with the exception of Greece, virtually all of the burden of the Eurozone crisis, of the accumulated debts, has been placed on the debtors. And that is largely because of the relationship between the Eurozone debt crisis and the euro itself, that is membership in the euro, and to some extent the bargaining power of the partners in question. But there's another dimension of every debt crisis and of the politics of a debt crisis, which is domestic. Within countries, conflict erupts, as it has in Europe, over how the adjustment burden will be distributed. Will the price be paid by taxpayers? Will it be paid by financial institutions? Will it be paid by workers in the private sector, in the public sector, beneficiaries of public services? Who will pay the price for the adjustments that have to be carried out in the countries in question? This is true both in the debtor countries and the creditor countries, because in the creditor countries, there's a question as to whether whatever debt restructuring takes place should be taken out of the hides of the financial institutions or should be paid for by taxpayers or someone else. So throughout the Eurozone, both across countries and within countries, there are continuing conflicts over how this crisis will be dealt with. And the extraordinary and extraordinarily sad fact is that essentially there has been virtually no progress in dealing with this debt burden. There has been, with the exception of Greece, no debt restructuring, despite the fact, I think if you had polled economic observers of the Eurozone in 2010 or 11, you would have found that 95% of them at least, perhaps not in the Eurozone itself, but certainly in the US and certainly among my colleagues, would have said, oh yes, well, as in all debt crises, these debts will have to be restructured. They're not sustainable. They can't be serviced as the contracts were written. They'll have to be restructured. It's simple. It's a simple Pareto improvement in the interest both of the creditors and the debtors to lessen the immediate burden of the debt so that growth can resume. That has not happened. Instead, there has been a continued effort to impose the debts as they were contracted, which has meant round after round of attempts to impose austerity on the debtor countries and round after round of, you know, fictitious attempts to pretend that all is well and that these debts will eventually be serviced as they were contracted. It has not worked. It will not work. There is both economic and political, there are both economic and political reasons why the debts will eventually have to be restructured in one way or another. They might be inflated away. That seems unlikely. They might be negotiated away. There might be some form of debt relief provided. Eventually, that will happen. The longer the member states of the Eurozone perseverate and delay a restructuring of these debts, the greater the cost to overall growth in the area, the greater the political cost to every member state government, and the greater the political cost to the European Union. So while all of this procrastination goes on, while this gridlock takes hold, and the gridlock in Europe makes our gridlock in the US look like child's play, while the gridlock takes hold and prohibits or has blocked any underlying long-term resolution of the crisis, meanwhile, median income in the Eurozone and in virtually every country in the Eurozone continues to drop. Median household wealth continues to drop. Policymakers appear to have no solution to the crisis, whether at the European level or at the national level, and people start to lose faith, both in their national governments and in the institutions of the European Union. So that the economic crisis has led to a political crisis, has led to an extraordinarily severe crisis of confidence. If you look at public opinion polls on what confidence in the European Union and in national governments look like, it has collapsed. In the debtor countries, confidence in both national governments, and these are answers to Eurobarometer questions, confidence in both national governments and the institutions of the European Union were in the 60 to 70% range before the crisis. They're now around 15 or 20%. Right? Even in the creditor countries, the countries that have done relatively well, confidence has fallen well below the majority level, and in some cases it's collapsed completely. Not only confidence in the European Union, but confidence in the institutions of national government. So as in Europe, as in the United States, we see turn towards a loss of confidence in the willingness and ability of national political institutions to confront serious economic problems. As that gathers force, anti-system parties and anti-system movements gain credit in the body politic, and this could easily spiral downward. One thing I would point out, by the way, which is to some extent just reinforces the point that I'm trying to make, is that if you look at the actual ideological placement of Europeans, that is, within their countries and overall, Europeans have not become more extreme. That is, the same proportion of, say, Spaniards or Germans or Swedes or Finns or Italians that call themselves left or extreme left or extreme right, same proportion as 10, 15 years ago, maybe a 1% increase in some countries. But the willingness of voters in those countries to vote for extremist parties has skyrocketed. The number of people, the proportion of the electorate willing to vote for extremist parties in Spain and Greece is about 6 times the number who say that they have ideological positions that are in line with that. It's a protest vote. It's a vote against existing political elites, just as, in my view, the vote for Trump in many instances in the US was. The sad part is that this process will continue as long as the economic crisis is not resolved. There is a greater and greater need for progress in trying to address the economic consequences of the crisis. There is an ever greater urgency to addressing the economic consequences of the crisis. And yet, as far as I can see, there has been little movement among the member states of the European Union. And here I would blame not the institutions of the EU, but the member states themselves in negotiating towards a more acceptable settlement, which will try to lessen both the economic and the political and the social burden and economic, political, and social implications of the most serious crisis in modern European history. And on that happy note.
Wow. Well, I'm glad you weren't the last speaker, because now we have some room to create some hope, maybe. Hans-Helmut.
So this could be, in fact, my shortest talk ever given. If I would answer the question, is the euro crisis zone over? No. But I would also like to somehow, though I usually largely agree with what Jeff says, comment on Jeff, but I'd like to go into an issue which has to do with macroeconomics and the macroeconomic institutions which we have in Europe. And there, in particular, I'd like to touch upon the question of monetary policy and its interaction with fiscal policy. In order to do that, I do think we should not start with our knowledge of the crisis is happening. We should start with what those who have constructed this institution in the late 1980s and early 1990s thought. So whilst we all now agree this institutional setup is deeply flawed, that was somehow not the conventional wisdom at the time. Even in 2009, you had a very good article written by very good economic historian from Sweden, who listed all the flaws of the Americans who were criticizing the institutional setup of the monetary union. And in fact, it was interesting to see that those critiques over the course of the 2000s, went away from their critique. So this has only recently emerged. And that's the only moment now where I criticize my good friend Jeff. It's, of course, wrong. Flatly wrong to claim that debt restructuring was the dominating view in 2010 or 2011. There's a paper by the IMF, Carlo Cottarelli and others, unnecessary. What was it? I was just picking it.
Unwise.
Unnecessary, unwanted, and unlikely. So that was the dominant view in public policy circles, even in May 2010. There was, of course, also the dominating view of those who dealt at the time at the BIS in Brussels with the Greek debt crisis. So I do think we have quite an amount of Monday morning quarterbacking going on here, in particular also in academic circles. So sorry for being so
blunt. I meant American academics, but we can come back to that. Yeah.
But the main point I would like to address have to do with the Maastricht institutional setup, what macroeconomic policy should look like, how it was intended to be. And that was, by the way, at that time, just copy-pasted from your standard textbook. It was about monetary policy has to achieve a decent level of inflation, underwrite purchasing power. Fiscal policy has to care for solidly financing your public sector, your public goods, keeping in line with the intertemporal budget constraint. And what what's happening with labor and with wages and employment is an issue of labor markets. So there was a clear separation of labor, a division of labor amongst the three macro handmaidens, and that was the conventional view. It was in particular deemed to be appropriate for the European case because we do, of course, not have this setup which you have in a nation state where there's one monetary authority, one financial or fiscal policy authority, and usually or quite often, at least that was the case in Germany, a cooperative employers and labor union movement. So this setup was not the European one, and hence one went for a rule-oriented blueprint, which had the so-called stability and growth pact with debt and deficit levels. And this appeared to somehow work until 2008, just until the crisis, somehow. I have to confess, I was at the time never really convinced of this setup because this clear assignment of responsibilities actually meant that you basically took out most of the macro stabilization. European Monetary Union member states are characterized by an institutional setup which has lots of automatic stabilizers, much more than you have here in the US. But I thought in times of crisis you might need more of a discretionary capacity on the side of fiscal policy. Actually, that's what I'm coming at the end of my brief presentation to. But the Europeans at that time, policymakers, didn't deem that to be useful. So now the crisis hit, and I have a few, if I may, few data slides on that, if I can manage to get them up. No, I don't. Peter? Okay. So it's the response of monetary policy, fiscal policy, and how it
Wait, you need the screen.
Huh. Oh. Okay.
It's only have it here.
Okay, maybe it's still warming up. Okay.
So the European system was massively shocked, as many other systems, as a result of the crisis, which basically meant that suddenly interbank money markets, and at the time when it happened, we actually didn't know that this was such a long-lasting crisis. The end of the crisis was predicted numerous times before it really hit. So this was the shock which drove the European Monetary Union, if you like, from the road. This is the spread between secured and unsecured interbank money markets, and it went to unprecedented levels. So this is Lehman, AIG, and so forth. In fact, during the second phase of the crisis, the monetary union was still perceived as being a shield to protect the smaller monetary union members from bad things happening. That's what you see here. So into the crisis, this was still seen as a shock absorption mechanism. And the end of 2009, the two-year government bond yields in Greece were 20 basis points higher than in Germany, end of 2009. So the setup which we had might have worked for non-crisis environment, but later on learned it did not work for non-crisis environments. And now my 2 points which I'd like to address. Monetary policy and fiscal policy by necessity, inexorably, work through what Jim Tobin called the common funnel, by necessity, so that you cannot separate them. Which means if you would like to achieve the goals of monetary and fiscal policy in the European case, you would like to have an impulse of both macro handmaidens, which allows you to A, achieve your price stability objective, and B, to get the economy growing again. What you see here are the output gaps of France, Germany, Italy, and so forth. I've put Germany in red because it has a positive output gap, it has a surplus. And most of the European economies, these are OECD numbers, are in significant output, have significant output gaps, so much room to grow. The problem of Europe is, of course, that we don't have a coordinated fiscal policy, that fiscal policy at the euro area level happens by default. And in an uncoordinated way also with monetary policy. The US is in a much better situation somehow because they at least have the opportunity or possibility to coordinate. So we have very great variance in output gaps in Europe. And we have a monetary policy which has basically run out of its ammunition, or almost out of its. It has had to become very, very unconventional. So the upshot of that is, of course, that monetary policy and fiscal policy interacting in Europe do not suffice to create a macro environment which could nurture and which could support growth. Those were the data slides I wanted to use, and this is now just copy-pasted from the last OECD economic outlook from last June. So what we have as a problem here, as an issue to answer here, is how do we get a European area-wide monetary policy, fiscal policy, which suffices to support growth? And there are three options, and with those options I conclude. The first would be we have a fiscal capacity at the euro area level which would allow for a quasi-automatic stabilization of output deviations from trend. The second would be much less plausible, much more difficult to implement, a discretionary way of doing this within the institutions which we now have in Europe, the Economic and Financial Committee and so forth. A third option is we continue to do what we do. That's probably the most plausible one. European monetary and fiscal policy at the euro area level are coordinated, if you like, by default. That's the most plausible one and also the saddest one, because it will ultimately mean that we will continue to suffer. Continue to suffer in terms of going on with the modeling through. And this modeling through must not come to an end, but it can become very slumpy, very nasty. It can become an environment which is in particular politically very difficult to handle because it implies, and that's again where I completely agree with you, Jeff, it implies lots of hardship. So maybe the positive note, I haven't looked at it.
You're fine.
Maybe the positive note on that is Europe always advanced by crisis. So I'm referring, of course, to Monet. We had now two very significant crises, and they were somehow successful. We managed to organize in the banking union domain institutions which we couldn't have hoped of even in 2009. So possibly we need another real hardship to get our act together macro-wise, which wouldn't be that innovative because all those propositions, the three which are made or the one which I highlighted, have been first time mentioned in the McDougall report of 1977 when the monetary union was thought of as being a solution to Europe's troubles. So let me end there.
Thank you very much, Hans-Helmut. That was slightly more encouraging, although I would agree with you that if we keep muddling through as we have so far, we may be in serious trouble down the line. We're already in serious trouble
The question is, where is that going, right? And Europe doesn't seem to have found yet the ability to jolt itself out of this muddling through. So let's hear from Peter what you think the consequences of this could be.
Okay, I'm going to use a PowerPoint. So is there any chance we can have the
screen back?
The screen back? Or is that a, because I'm not sure my slides will be visible. Sign in, it says sign in. All right, just a second here. Minimize this. Oh, no, here we go. That's all right. So that's it. So what do I have to do to make it large? Panasonic, okay.
I've seen that one.
Can you hear
saw
me?
Saw that presentation already.
Yeah, okay. Well, I'll start and you can see the slides on this. The first one's pretty easy to see. So is the Eurozone crisis over? That's the question. And in recent years, I think it's been widely noted, and indeed correctly noted, that the Euro crisis really entails three separate but interlinked crises, a sovereign debt crisis, a banking crisis, and a growth crisis. Well, how well has the European Union done on each of those? And I want to say something about this briefly before getting to my main point. So I would say the following, cryptically, briefly. On the sovereign debt crisis, I think we might give the European Union 9 marks out of 12. That's what the stars on the 9 gold stars out of 12. So ever since Mario Draghi promised to do whatever it takes, and implemented a policy of outright monetary transactions, speculation against sovereign debt in Europe and corresponding yields have declined. But Germany and the IMF, as many people here will know, are locked in debate about what to do about Greek debt, and Greek debt is, I think, manifestly unsustainable. And at 133% of GDP, Italian debt is high, and at least poses some kind of risk of another such crisis. That's a sovereign debt crisis. On resolving the banking crisis, I would give the EU about 6 out of 12. So initial steps have been taken towards banking union, as you know, including some EU supervision, the first pillar anticipated there, and procedures for dealing with insolvent banks, the second pillar of banking union. But the funds set aside for resolving insolvent banks are clearly insufficient, in my view. And Europe is full of zombie banks, as Jeff Frieden said, with high levels of non-performing loans on their books. It's interesting that the era we live in is dominated by vampire movies and discussion of zombies. I think it says something, but this is not the Center for Cultural Studies. levels of non-performing loans are, of course, impeding cross-border lending, as Jeff said, on which investment and the economic success of the union depends. So 6 out of 10. And on resolving the growth crisis, I think we can grant the EU at best 4 marks out of 12. You can see I'm not using the Harvard grading scale, which would run between roughly 10 and 12 marks out of 12. So after 8 years, euro area GDP has barely returned to 2008 levels. Overall levels of growth and investment in the euro area, as Jeff said, are anemic, notwithstanding the optimism we want to attach to the very recent uptick, and they lag those in the U.S. Moreover, and I think perhaps even more important, the distribution of growth is very uneven. Rates of unemployment remain very high in southern Europe, and I see myself no reason to think that the policies imposed on those countries by the European Union are going to significantly reduce those rates of unemployment anytime soon. However, the main point I want to make is that this tripartite sense that there are 3 crises inside the euro crisis, this tripartite sense, this list is incomplete. There's a fourth dimension to the euro crisis, namely a political crisis defined in terms of declining levels of trust in the EU, declining levels of trust in national governments, as Jeff mentioned, and a corresponding shift in national electorates away from mainstream parties that implemented the response to the crisis toward political newcomers, often on the radical left and radical right. And we know a lot about this, and we heard about it from Wolfgang Merkel and Pippa Norris this morning. And this political crisis is not only unresolved, but it's intensifying. Now, you might argue that this backlash is a natural response to recession. I don't know whether Jeff would argue that or not, but we can see. Natural response to any financial crisis. And so this political crisis is largely exogenous to the European Union itself. But I want to suggest a different interpretation. I think that this political crisis was exacerbated and indeed in large measure generated by the way in which the European Union responded to the economic crisis. The key mistake, more or less from the beginning, was to treat the euro crisis largely as an economic crisis, rather than seeing it as a set of events that posed a fundamental challenge to the political formula on which the EU is based, i.e. the prevailing model, widely consensual, of how the European Union operates. That model assumes that, so that's what I just said, that model assumes that as problems arise, those problems should be addressed by giving the European Union ever greater authority over ever wider ranges of policy. And of course, this model has a distinguished pedigree. We can see it in federalist ideals, and it has a theoretical rationale in economic arguments about spillovers. And this model dictated how the EU would respond to the euro crisis, namely by elaborating a new set of rules that imposed fiscal austerity on its member states, often accompanied by highly detailed and onerous structural reforms at intense levels of detail, if you think about the case of Greece. And I think this model, the political formula of the EU, is still reflected in the highly influential view among European elites that what the euro really needs is a fuller fiscal or political union. My friend Hans-Helmut Kotz has just identified himself as a member of the European elite in that sense. But I think this is exactly wrong. It makes good sense in technical terms, but it makes no sense in political terms. Economic performance goes up and it goes down. That in turn makes electorates happy or discontent. And because electorates are sometimes discontent, every polity needs a safety valve. That means the electorate needs to feel that the government that it elected is responsible for that performance. So in some sense, that electorate is responsible for that performance, and that that government can be held accountable for its performance, if necessary, by electing an opposition devoted to different policies. In the context of the euro crisis, I think the European Union has taken away that safety valve. And it's done so partly because many European policymakers believe that economic policymaking is a purely technical matter. In other words, they think that there is one true path to economic growth, a single set of best practices, and their main task then is to ensure that national governments follow those practices, pursue that path. But I think there's more than one way to secure economic growth. That's a subject I've written about extensively. And the choices among these different routes to economic growth have serious distributive consequences. Some people gain, others lose. In other words, they're the kind of choices that electorates feel, quite rightly, that they're entitled to make. Of course, there are other reasons why elite opinion in the EU favors this centralization of authority over economic policymaking. And in this is in large measure because from the very beginning of the single currency, EU leaders have been obsessed with free riding. They worry that at any point in time, some countries might be benefiting at the expense of others. And this is understandable, of course. Hence the Stability and Growth Pact. Hence prohibitions against industrial subsidies built into the competition policy. Hence the recent edict that governments cannot bail out the bondholders in their own banks. But all of these policies, all of these edicts, rule out policies that might well yield higher rates of growth, especially in the parts of Europe that desperately need higher rates of growth. And they turn national governments into eunuchs. Is it any wonder that national electorates have started to long for politicians with testicles or their gender-neutral equivalent? So what is to be done? I think the EU should be loosening rather than tightening its requirements on national governments. It should be decentralizing responsibility for economic policy back to national governments. The result may be, or it may not be, higher levels of growth. But giving national governments more autonomy has at least as much chance of securing economic growth, I think, as current policies do. And even more important, it puts responsibility for economic performance back where it belongs, with national electorates and the governments they elect. Of course, such an approach requires that EU governments stop worrying so much about free riding. It requires a willingness to take some risks, notably the risk that one or another of the member states might default on its sovereign debt. But most of all, it requires a recognition that the European Union is composed of very different member states, each with its own needs, each with its own aspirations. And frankly, I think that recognition of different member states with their own needs and aspirations has long been the most solid basis on which to build common European aspirations. To do otherwise is an act of hubris, and we know about hubris. Hoch Mut kommt vor dem Fall. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. Well, thank you, Peter, for very enlightening thoughts. I'm sure that we'll have many questions from the audience about the consequences of your recommendations. Should we move on to Christopher?
Thank you. This is an excellent panel, and I hope I don't draw down the average too much in my presentation. I woke up last Wednesday morning, as probably many of you did, and went straight to my wallet and pulled out my credentials as an analyst of the global political economy, with my certificates in prediction of political and financial market trends, and promptly walked them over to my shredder, but was stopped when I realized that today I was appearing on a panel called Is the Euro Crisis Over?, which seems to suggest I should make some predictions, and so I have saved them back under my pile of papers at home. And I'll probably pull them out again and start making predictions as the rest of us will, because it's just too tempting not to. What I wanted to do this morning in the time that I have is to talk a little bit, not so much about the future of the euro or the European Union, but as I see it, some of the forces, the big forces I think we as analysts and scholars need to start thinking about that will drive that future. And then I want to talk about sort of a specific area of endeavor within the euro that I think we need to concentrate our efforts both as practitioners and analysts. The big forces clearly are the populism and nationalism we've seen in recent elections, and the panel prior to ours I think did an excellent job exposing a lot of those trends, particularly I think pointing out that what we label as nationalism and populism is really, you know, looks similar at one distance, but when you get closer up, there are a lot of different things going on in the UK and in Spain than are going on in Iowa and Arizona. But I think there is undeniably a trend, a political trend, towards pulling back from global integration, pulling back from freer trade, pulling back from all of the forces that we thought made the world smaller. The second force, however, continues to be the broader economic and technological trends that have been driving our world closer together. And those will not change regardless of the electoral results. We will still have technologies. We will still have improvements in transportation, improvements in digital analytics that will make the world move at a faster pace and force us in many ways, I think, to come together. And that is a whole subject for another morning or weekend of conversation. But I think we need to understand that those things will not change. The third element where I'm going to focus some of my remarks are on the institutions, which remain in place to grapple with both the political forces on one side and the economic and technological change on the other side. And within Europe, within the European Union, I think, as we have seen and as we've heard today, those institutions continue to get stronger. The European Union, the European Parliament continues to get more power. The European Commission continues to have a more and more important role in people's lives around the European Union. All you need to do is to look at the number of law firms and lobbyists who have set up shop in Brussels over the last 5 years to convince you that something important is going on here. And I think even as everything that my fellow panelists have done to point out the problems, which are real and manifest, I think it's important to understand that these are not institutions that are weak and crumbling. They will no doubt be reshaped by the political trends that we are witnessing, but they're not going to go away. And they will be there to grapple with both the political changes on the one hand and the technological changes on the other hand. In Europe in particular, I would argue that there are three institutions that are probably strongest and most influential in shaping the future of the euro. And the EU more broadly. One, and this was actually part of my comments plagiarized from Radek Sikorski, who was sitting here a few weeks ago and was pointing out that two, I'm not sure if he had the full list, but in any case, I will give him some credit for this list. DG Comp and DG Trade are perhaps the two most powerful commissioners in the European Union and in Europe as a whole. Radek Sikorski made the point, the provocative point, I think, that Margaret Thatcher would be cheering for the European Union today because it is the institution within Europe that is most responsible for a level playing field in terms of competition and for boosting free trade agreements for Europe with the rest of the world. The third institution is, of course, the European Central Bank. And that's where I'd like to spend the rest of my time because I think it is the European Central Bank that is the, whether it's the unsung hero or the sung hero, it is the hero of the euro crisis. It is the single institution that was able to come together and during the most difficult and tumultuous political conversations, whether it was over restructuring Irish bank debt, whether it was the famed walk on the beach in Deauville, or whether it was ultimately the commitment to through open monetary transactions to do whatever it takes to protect the institutions of the euro. The ECB has been there from the start, and it was initially the shock absorber for flows of money in and out of countries in crisis and into more perceived safe havens. It offered liquidity to banks in need. The whole Target 2 system was there to help absorb a lot of these shocks. And I think it is it and the institutions around the ECB that will determine the shape of the euro banking system is where the action is. So I will not venture to make any predictions today. But I will offer some suggestion that the action will be over whether or not Europe comes to grips with the pressures on its banking system. I think it is ambitious to think that there will be progress on safe European bonds. I think it is ambitious to think that any improvements in labor mobility stand much of a chance in the next few years in the current political crisis. But I would argue that it is possible, at least, with proper policy design, with good engagement by political leaders, with electorates, to make the case that it is a common banking system that was there in the crisis, that is there now, and that must be reinforced in order for the euro to emerge as a stronger place. I don't think there's any chance anytime soon of the euro becoming an optimum currency area, but I think it could survive and prosper to some extent as a suboptimum currency area if the progress that the ECB has made on becoming a single supervisor continues to progress. We need to see them on paper. I think it all looks fairly reasonable, but we need to see them sort of build up a track record of resolving a bank, which may come sooner than we think, but I think that's important. I think there's obviously needs to be attention paid to filling up this bank resolution fund with contributions from the banking sector, but probably doing it faster rather than slower. I think we need to think more seriously about ways to limit bank sovereign exposures so that they are more diversified and we continue to break this debt sovereign bank feedback loop that has been such an important part of the heart of the financial crisis. I agree with almost everything that Jeff Frieden said earlier. I think the problem was not so much countries borrowing as much as it was banks borrowing. It was really an overextension of the banking system that we're now trying to pull back onto more solid ground. I think it's an interesting intellectual exercise, if nothing else, to think if the Greek crisis had not struck first, or if Greece were not part of the euro area, we really would be focusing on issues in Ireland and Portugal and Italy and Spain, which are much more bank-centric than anything else. So I would only suggest that we focus. The most immediate challenges are likely to come down the pike very quickly in Italy. Excuse me. There are headlines today. There are conversations underway about Monte dei Paschi, which will be an important test case, probably not until after the referendum. We've all seen the headlines about a large bank in Germany, which
unnamed.
You could argue, you know, some uncertainty will be taken off the table sooner rather than later if there is a view that coming to terms with the current Department of Justice is better than coming to terms with the next Department of Justice. I won't speculate on that.
The markets will.
The markets will, certainly, with every tweet that comes out. And then lastly, I think we still have some big unresolved problems with Portuguese banks that need to be addressed, and it's sort of floated along under the radar, but I think how these issues are resolved and what those resolutions say about the balance of supervision and pooled responsibility, I think, you know, Jeff and others have been absolutely right. It is, the crisis is really over who is going to bear these costs. Who is going to bear the responsibility of the oversight. And I think as we see each of these test cases in the weeks and months ahead resolved, I think that will give us some sense of where the monetary union is headed.
Great. Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you very much. This was a fantastic panel. Jeffry, you obviously told us about the issues going forward, and you know, you're not so optimistic about the lack of progress that you've seen in Europe fundamentally. Hans-Helmut, you told us about the nexus between fiscal and monetary policies and the kind of path going forward and the concern that we may continue to muddle through to an unhappy path. Peter, you told us about the three or four crisis that you actually see, and you actually put forward some interesting solutions about going back to a more decentralized decision making. And Christopher, you gave us an overall view of what is going on, and with a particular focus on the banking situation, which you see still as being central to the potential propagation of a new wave of crisis. So we have lots to talk about. Why don't we open it up for questions? Let's start with Paul.
My question actually does draw on what each of you said. It kind of ends up with Peter and Hans-Helmut, I think. Christopher has painted a picture where the main actor, by a long way, is the ECB, which, unlike other advanced economy central banks, isn't a creature of primary legislation, which the legislature could revisit, but is at constitutional level. And furthermore, it's at a part of a constitution which is incomplete in terms of the normal way of arranging these things. And is this part of the... And so we find that it gets challenged... When it gets challenged via the courts. My personal view is that there's something spectacularly wrong when one bunch of unelected people, constitutional judges, end up determining the existential role of another bunch of unelected people, my tribe of central bankers. And so my question to you is this part of the European crisis? If we go back to the previous panel, where there was talk of a demos, how far are we away from a demos when the only actor is a constitutionally very powerful body of unelected technocrats.
All right, let's take a couple of more questions. You have the mic.
I found the presentation very interesting. Peter had, I thought, raised an interesting point. Somewhere in the middle of your presentation, you alluded to possibility of closer union in terms of monetary policy and fiscal policy. And then later on in your presentation, you went down the opposite route of decentralization.
Did you just said something? I didn't hear.
I thought it was supposed to be
off. So I'm just wondering, could you be a little bit more specific in terms of what your recommendations are in terms of solving the crisis? Is it one way or the other? And my question is, you know, there is this trinity in having the exchange rate, the fiscal policy, and monetary policy. In the case of Europe, you have two that are relatively free and one that's fixed. So as a result, to Jeffrey's point, of imbalances between debt and credit countries, for instance, imbalances that resulted in these credits and debits due to, for instance, differences in productivity. When these three components of the Trinity are not one, how exactly will these imbalances be resolved? Where is the outlet valve for these pressures and differences to be resolved?
Okay. Should we take one more and then at the back maybe there's somebody?
The debt overhang. Creditors want deflation, borrowers want inflation. Bank lends money to buy one Spanish house that now they can, with that same money, they can buy two. But of course that can lead to a lack of demand and high unemployment. So how do we resolve that? And the related issue of trade imbalances, both internal, and if the periphery is going to be forced into surpluses, how about external balances with the rest of the world?
Okay. All right, why don't we start answering some of these? You want to start?
Yeah, I mean, again, I apologize for leaving early because I do have to go run our research workshop. So I'm probably just, this will probably be my last comment, the last ability. So I'll shoot and leave, and I apologize for that. So I wanted to cover some of the issues that were raised and some of the ones that were raised on the panel. Pretty much everyone addressed what I think is the core tension, in some sense, in the longer term sense. That is not, I was talking more about what's going on with the crisis immediately. Hans-Helmut and Peter, I think, very accurately identified what I think of as being the core tension. On the one hand, it is unquestionably the case, as Peter says, that mass electorates feel that too much power has been taken away from national governments and given either to a bunch of intransigent creditor countries that have a lot of bargaining power and able to impose austerity on them, or to unelected, your colleagues, Paul, your unelected central bankers or the judiciary. That's clearly a very important part of the political political difficulties that we face. On the other hand, I think Hans-Helmut is exactly right that in a single market with a currency union, there are massive externalities and important scale economies and important need. There is a real necessity for some form of coordination of some kinds of policies. One of the problems that we face, as Hans-Helmut's presentation, I think, illustrated, is that countries have been undertaking important national policies with little and really no regard for the broader European implications of their policies. When you have a country running a surplus of 8% of GDP in the context of a massive regional debt crisis, you know there's something wrong with either that country's internalization of the effects of its policies on its partners or with the coordination that goes on among those partners. And frankly, it's both. There is not enough coordination on fiscal and other policies, and there's not enough national understanding of the implications of national policies on the union. The same thing's true with banking union. I think the banking, I mean, people keep talking about, well, now we have rules for the banking union. Now the ECB is going to be supervising these 131 systemically important banks. I want to see what happens when the ECB, if it goes this far, because, you know, an equilibrium might not make a demand that's not going to be met. But the ECB says these two banks have to be wound up. And the two banks in question are Monte dei Paschi and Deutsche Bank, two national champions. National governments have tremendous political incentives to maintain the solvency of insolvent national champions. They've been doing it for 200 years, and they're going to continue to do it. So you can have banking union all you want, but there are incredibly powerful national political pressures to find exceptions when powerful interests are at stake. So the core problem that Peter and Hans-Helmut have forced us to wrestle with is how do you square appropriate attention to the legitimate demands of national publics and including national special interests on the one hand with a union that requires much more coordination and cooperation than we currently see. That's the core, the crux of the problem. I think, and this goes back to what I was saying, I think that it has to start with addressing the current crisis. That and this goes again goes back to what Hans-Helmut, I would still hold to the view that at in 2010, 2011, every American specialist I talked to said, of course these debts are going to have to be restructured. I talked to Carmen Reinhart and Ken Rogoff. We couldn't think of, we sat down at one point, we could not think of a debt crisis in which there wasn't debt restructuring, major debt restructuring. And I remember being at the German finance ministry at a big public meeting with a bunch of American academics, and German academics too, and a bunch of German policymakers, and the academics were unanimous that there was going to have to be, and that includes German academics like Henrik Underline and Peter Wolfinger, and the policymakers were unanimous that there couldn't be any debt restructuring. That circle has to be squared. There has to be a more constructive approach to the existing debts, and that's the starting point. I think that if that is impossible, then at some level, the European Union is impossible.
All right. Thank you very much for that positive note. Hans-Helmut, would you like to
address? I would like
address?
To make 3 points, and I'll start possibly with Jeff because he's running away. I do think there's for sure the situation of over indebtedness in at least one country, no doubt about that. But I was not referring to my view on this issue. I was referring to the view of policymakers in 2010 who were faced with a banking system which was 9 months after the nadir of the crisis, and they were not sure at all that as a result of a debt restructuring you wouldn't see the whole system implode again. So that was more financial stability issue, and there was no courage to take that risk. The second point has to do with Paul's remark on the European demos, and I'll start with Peter. Peter quoted, I don't know whom, Hochmut kommt vor dem Fall. I quote a German sociologist, wir müssen die Folgen unseres Handelns lieben, Max Weber. We have to laugh the consequences of what we are doing. And I have not given in. whereas Peter has been given in, he thinks this has to be renationalized, decentralized. I don't, because if I would accept Peter's view, that would be the end of the euro. So this crumbling thing above there. We have a Europeanized monetary policy which comes inexorably. That's the physics of this, which comes inexorably with the minimum level of Europeanization in other policy domains for the spillover reasons you mentioned. But there's no option to have a common European currency with the level of variety which we currently see. And I'm unhappy to say that to a large degree I share the skepticism of Peter, but I haven't given in. And I know a reason why I haven't given in. De La Rosière, a very important European policymaker, wrote down a plan for the banking environment after the crisis, after the first crisis. So we're talking of 2009. And he came up with a blueprint which was very ambitious. Very ambitious, but only coordination. There was no single supervisory mechanism. There was no banking restructuring mechanism. There was no minimum level of deposit insurance scheme. I all find these three institutional devices insufficient, but they are way beyond what Europeans deemed to be achievable in 2009. So I do still think that there's reason not to give up. And in order to achieve more progress, what is important, possibly, that's what we did last week here, for example, to get Europeans together and get into a serious debate about the consequences. What they are doing. I do honestly think if this principled and non-responding way of policymaking between the North and the South continues, and Demos. Paul is highly endogenous. That's what you show with your Eurobarometer figures. Then we will end up with a Europe ever more divided. And I don't think we should, accept it. I see opportunities to get around that. And possibly we first have to start with our friends in Germany, the Netherlands, Finland, and so forth, but also the Italians.
Thank you. Thank you, Jeffrey. Thank you, Hans-Helmut. It's great that you are here today. I'm so glad you came to give us a little bit more hope here. Let's hear from Peter, maybe.
Okay. I can speak to some extent to Paul's question and the issue of specificity, although not so much, in part by responding to Hans-Helmut. It's fun to, so far anyway, it's fun to do this. I think the operative word in your suggestion, which is, of course, eminently plausible suggestion, is minimum level of coordination. And I think the debate hitherto has been one in which we've seen basically two options for the long-term viability of the euro. One is something much closer fiscal and political union on the one hand, and the other option has generally been posited as a breakup of the euro. And of course, there are good reasons for thinking that those are the two options. I'm trying to suggest, and I can't say that I have a wealth of empirical evidence behind this, that this is a panel, not a job talk, fortunately. I think that there is a middle position here, and it's one which would not suggest no coordination, but it would suggest that prohibiting many interventionist economic policies is an error. It would suggest that, and here I go to Paul Tucker's point, I entirely agree with you about the issues with the European Central Bank. It's very striking in comparing that bank to the Fed, although we may wish we went there. Pardon me?
The same issue
with the Supreme Court. Indeed. But I would, you know, I agree with Christopher that I think the European Central Bank was in some sense the hero of this crisis, in the same way that I think in some ways the Fed was the hero of the American side of that crisis. But what I do think is that when one then moves to give the European Central Bank authority over banking supervision and the resolution, that's a step that in some sense, without any giving them any accountability to political authorities, that is then a step too far. And I think that has been the story of this crisis. That is to say, the EU has acted, the EU is not a thing, of course, but too many policymakers have acted reflexively to think collectivizing the decision-making is the solution. And I'm suggesting that has gone too far, and it's true. I mean, it's true that I would not want to claim that, oh, we can resolve the economic crisis by devolving more authority over economic policymaking to national governments. I can't claim that, because it's not clear to me how to resolve that crisis in Southern Europe. And I also think that what governments should probably be doing is not, in some respects, so different from what the EU is pressing on them, not in all respects. But my point is that let's stop treating this as if it were simply an economic crisis. It's a political crisis. And even if the solutions to the political crisis might not be optimal from the point of view of the economic crisis, we have to recognize that there's a political crisis here, and it's not simply going to go away.
I would just add two thoughts. One is, I think the problem of a technocratic elite having such influences in our governments, notwithstanding the fact that we're here in the middle of Harvard University, is that it does tempt us. And I, you know, those of us who have served in government, I think we've all been part of conversations where we say, well, we know this is going to be a little sensitive, so let's put this off until after this election. It was certainly the case in our debate over TPP and broader trade issues in this country. The Obama administration did not want to engage any of that before the last midterm election. And I think a lot of other reasons intervened, but you know, that case was never really made to the American voter. Secondly, in Europe, there is always this endless, you know, we talk about European democracy and how wonderful it is, but there's an endless calendar of elections. And I don't know how many states there are in Germany, but it seems like there are 50, because every 2 weeks there's another German state election that we can't do anything because, that's my small rant on that front. I would only say, you know, I'm maybe becoming not less analytical and more normative, but I think you may be right that the ECB taking on this additional set of responsibilities is a step too far. But my argument would be it is the only conceivable next step, because all of the other issues that are so important to make the euro work better are now pushed back even further in terms of fiscal integration or political integration or that sort of thing. But I think it is conceivable that if the ECB comes in and says, look, this is a corrupt Portuguese bank. It's a bunch of cronies who have been lending to their best buddies, and we are going to come in and resolve it. That is not necessarily a vote loser in the next Portuguese election. I think you can play that story out if you have political leaders who are willing to say, this is, you know, we know why the euro is, why the European Union is difficult and awkward and a bunch of overpaid bureaucrats in Brussels. We know all of that, but it's also given us these benefits. And it's, you know, in Germany, it's actually made the exchange rate a little better for us. In all of these other, you know, we can travel. It's easier for small and medium enterprises to sell across the European Union, et cetera, et cetera. So I think it is incumbent upon political leaders to make that case and start with, you know, potentially more focused wins. And I would argue that lies mainly in reinforcing the ECB.
Thank you. We have 10 minutes or so time for one or more or two more questions. Before we do that, I just want to say that at 12:30 we have the lunch with Moscow VC. For those of you who haven't registered, the CES is arranged for the event to be live streamed in the Hoffman Room, and has also provided that lunch. So for those of you who are interested, you could stay here. Please.
Yeah, hi there. Peter. When you talk about decentralization, and it sounds to me really like what you're advocating in a way is moving back to the Maastricht rules, right? So the Maastricht rules would have stipulated, you know, or did stipulate no bailouts, et cetera. So, and I actually would agree with you, and I just like to ask, so are you saying then you think the big mistake was bailing out Greece, right, in the first place, and they should have stuck with the rules? And secondly, if we would go back hypothetically or try to go back to that, well, what's going to be different this time that would lead political leaders to make a different decision? Is it that, because we've heard, you know, from Chris and Hans-Helmut in different ways that, you know, the banking union, although there's been big progress, it's not, you know, fully in place and there might still be fears, et cetera. So do you think, you know, they would have any more bravery, let's say, to let that happen this time? And I just say that I'm very sympathetic to your, you know, your argument, but I guess what I would say is that it seems the vote loser, the real place where they've gone too far is, you know, the fiscal centralization, the micromanagement of fiscal rules, right? And they had to do that. But I don't know, to say that they should undo banking union, then you can't have a single market in finance if you don't have banking union. We've showed that, right? So then you might as well forget the whole single market. I just, you know, there I'd agree with Chris.
Okay. Any other questions down here?
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. What do you think about what role Russia played in this crisis of Europe or European Union? Thank you very much.
Sorry, can you
Russia?
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay, Peter, do you want
to? I say something to Dan Kellerman. Yes, in some sense, I mean, it's not exactly a return to the past, but the original idea was that national default would be possible and market discipline would have some impact on national governments. And, of course, there was a certain amount of political lack of realism about that, to be sure. But I do think that we now live after the Euro crisis and that national governments might be a little more conscious of the constraints from the international financial markets, and so it's not unreasonable to think that market discipline would work. Was it a mistake to bail out Greece? Well, I actually think Greece would be better off today if it had defaulted. And I mean, who's to say whether I'm right or wrong, right? But I think a good argument can be made that Greece would be better off if it had simply defaulted and then had to go through a very painful restructuring program, but without some of the constraints it faces today. On the other hand, no, I don't think there was an option to not bail out Greece, because I think the effects, the contagion effects on the Eurozone and the European financial system were probably so great as to make that a non-starter, which means that Yes, you're perfectly right. I mean, at some level, there will be spillovers, and this would be a huge one. And the I'm not saying the EU should never respond to the problems of its member states, nor am I saying that it should not provide any guidance whatsoever to national governments. I just say that it, like the movie, it's a bridge too far. It's gone too far in that direction, and it's generating, exacerbating a political backlash, and it's time, somebody said that, and that we realized it. I certainly don't think that, I don't mean to imply that we shouldn't have banking union. I mean, I think banking union is crucial. I have some questions about whether a European Central Bank that is entirely independent, that is to say, not at all responsible to an elected body. I mean, the solution to that is to make the European Central Bank a little more responsive to an elected body, not to get rid of banking union, I think. So.
All right.
And Russia, yes, everybody seems to admire Mr. Putin these days. It's Russia's. So we're talking about the Euro crisis. I should stop and let somebody else. Why don't you answer that? I have things to say, but I'll stop.
All right, Christopher, do you
have? On Russia, there's lots of debate or lots of bits and pieces of evidence and reports about how Russians have been financing different parts of the European political spectrum. I think those are probably issues that we need to address. Clearly, I think most of us would agree those are not the core issues that are the problems that are driving the Euro crisis right now. They may be aggravating them on the margins. I just wanted to get back to something that Jeff said and Hans-Helmut just said earlier. And you alluded to, Peter, in terms of the debts and the levels of debts and the need to restructure these debts, I would argue that the sovereign debt levels aren't great, but those aren't the problems. It's really the bank debts and the non-performing loans within the banks that continue to clog up the system. Greece today, if you forgave all of their debts magically, you still aren't going to get any investment into the country because it's run by a dysfunctional management team. And moreover, their debt service is a very small portion of their annual budget. So I don't think we need to focus so much on the sovereign debts as we do on the bank debts.
Hans-Helmut, last word.
Peter didn't only want to go beg on banking union. Actually, he was talking about industrial policy, which you might sensibly talk about. He was talking about state aid, which you might sensibly talk about. But those are features of the Rome Treaty of 1957. So he went back before 57. You might wish to do that. I'm not really unfair, Peter. You might wish to do that. But this would come with a completely different setup. And I cannot imagine how monetary union can work in an environment where you have such a discrepancy in terms of policy and intervention. The second point is, and there I completely agree with Peter, that we have a major issue of delegitimization of policy making, which stems from no ownership at the national level because it's always inflicted by those bad bureaucrats. By the way, they are not that many. And they aren't those who are inflicting it. It's the council, it's nation states which are sitting together and then later on scapegoating the process bureaucrat. And final point, very quickly, I prefer very much the way the Bank of England goes about for very substantial reasons, monetary policy and banking policy. They call it one money, one bank. In terms of crisis, and somebody sitting here who knows much more than I do about that, in terms of crisis, the separation between monetary authority and the authority which is providing liquidity via the stabilizing function of the central bank balance sheet is very, very socially costly. So that's why you would have this institution, those two policy-making institutions together, they are joint products. And the SRM, by the way, is, of course, not part of the ECB. And I do think if one goes into the nitty-gritties of the single supervisory mechanism, that is the implementation of supervisory function, Chris has spoken to that, the ECB has been doing a quiet job up to now. Again, it's unbelievable. I'm ending on a somehow positive note.
Oh, thank you. That's why I kept you.
Grazie.
So it says grazie. That's why I kept you for the end. Thank you very much, our panelists. It was great. Lovely.
Thank you.